Hello and welcome to the Ascendant Cast. It is your boy John.
And your boy Matt.
And we got our boy Austin.
Hey guys.
Austin Trousas. We're minus Shiloh today.
It's tragic, honestly.
I think it's because you're a cop.
Yeah. Shiloh said it's cop day, I'm out.
Shiloh, you know what's funny is like when I run into Shiloh at
Arrowhead.
So like when I work the jails, I would run into Shiloh at Arrowhead and like I would like actively ask like security guards about, hey dude, is Shiloh on tonight?
Yeah.
And they'd be like, oh yeah, he's somewhere.
He's somewhere.
Like, okay. But it like every night before I ended the night, for some reason, Shiloh would just walk up out of nowhere and just go, what's up, bro? And I'd say
this
something.
Lurking?
Yeah, no, like it's just like he passed through the pod in like the hospital pod where like all the emergency room inmates would be. And he'd like walk up to me and I'd be like, oh, what's up, bro? And we'd talk for about like 2 minutes and then he'd be like, yeah, dude, gotta go, dude.
I got a call.
And I'm like thinking like, damn, why so soon? Because, I mean, my job is to just sit on that inmate. So I'll
be behavioral health is acting up, dog.
I'll be at the hospital for like 7 hours just sitting there.
Oh, will
like,
you?
Yeah, I'll just be sitting there like, there's only so much to do, right? So you'll be on your phone, you'll be chalking it up with like the other officers or deputies that are there at the
security
hospital. Guards, like some of them, most of them are like retired cops, so they tell you their war stories and all that stuff, and I hear them from my dad all the time. So
I'm sure that's how a lot of cop nurses relationships start.
Yeah, the cop nurse relationship.
I would imagine
one of the deadliest things that can happen to cops, dude, is getting married to a nurse.
Yeah
is that like a thing?
Oh, dude, for sure.
Yeah.
But, like, there's, like, a horror story behind that?
Oh, no. I'm just poking fun at it because there's, like, this stereotypical thing that cops only date, like, nurses or
and they always
teachers.
Cheat on them.
Teachers.
Just,
like, anywhere, though, bro, it, like, everywhere is a cesspool.
I feel like divorce.
Everyone's fucking everyone everywhere.
I feel like no matter
if you're working in a restaurant.
Yeah.
The police department, a fucking gym, a fucking hospital. Everyone's all horned up, all stressed out.
Yeah. Horned up.
The hormones
are
wild.
I think a lot of it is like divorce rates are already like trending upwards in the U.S. because people just can't stick with one person anymore.
Yeah.
But along with that, you have to like think about the stressful situations that like cops and nurses, like they have common bonding things and not much else, right? Like, so they can bond over trauma, which can bring them close together. This is my take on it. Like, I don't know what the statistics or science behind it is, but
I can
like
agree with you so far.
My thought is like they have a mutual bond over trauma, and like normal people don't see, you know, gunshot victims or like the horrible things, the horrors of society. So I feel like they can bond over that stuff, and then they figure out later on down the line, maybe after a ring has already been introduced and a marriage certificate, that, hey, we really don't have a lot in common.
Besides,
so,
we go through some pretty fucked up shit.
Yeah. Besides, there's some messed up stuff that goes down.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I feel like that probably has a lot to do with it. On top of that, like, a lot of people, like, if you have a spouse that's, like, not in law enforcement or not in, like, an emergency service, you don't want to bring, like, the stuff you see home to them and tell them about how fucked up your day was. Or like, I always had, like, there was a deputy who would tell me when I was an explorer, when I was a kid, that he's like, dude, when you get on, and just don't take it home to your family, right? Like, because you're going to diminish whatever day your spouse had, right? Let's say your spouse works HR somewhere, or like your wife works HR. And then you come home and she's like, oh, let me tell you about my day. Regina was such a bitch.
Yeah.
She did not pass me the stapler.
Yeah.
And you're like, fuck, dude, I got in a foot pursuit. I fucked my knee up. Like, I had to chase this dude. This guy fought me. And then I had to go to like a baby not breathing call and like see that and counsel family. And
I'm sorry, Bridget didn't.
Yeah.
Come here, break.
Sorry you didn't get the stapler in a timely manner. But seriously, like, it's funny, but it's not funny because those are other people's real world issues, right?
Yeah.
Like, and not diminishing them. It's just, it's a different. It's amplified.
You don't need to be like one of them. It's not a competition.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think that's where, as I was going to say, I think that's where like mature communication comes in and being able to go and understand each other's worlds, realities, right? So it's like having a strong woman not saying that she's not strong to listen to those things, but sometimes maybe like if you were wanting to talk to her about it, she could hold the space to do so and understand that you're not trying to one up her, but you just need to talk.
Yeah.
Just and vice versa too. Whether her fucking stressful day was some bitch not fucking pulling through on getting some office supplies, you're not gonna sit there and be like, because when you start going, oh well, I went through this.
If you think that's fucked up.
Yeah, then you are going to diminish her. You are going to
invalidate.
And it's like, that's where it's like because, you know, just from in my experience, like Scarlett will call me and she was like, hey, like, you got a second? Like, I just need to get something off my chest. And it's like, you know, she works at In-N-Out, so how much real, like, you know, intense drama can there be? But it's just drama, right? It's just, she needs to just, wants to vent it out.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, okay, cool. And like, you know, that's where it's like, I think the communication can help out with that. But I mean, everyone's different, you know?
Yeah, it's true. And like, I have had, I mean, like previous relationships, I just don't understand, right? But my fiance, she's a deputy and we can talk to each other about the issues that we have, which is good.
Yeah.
And, but like, the thing is like a lot of cops stay cops off duty, right? Like they roll around like hut, like looking for danger and like all this stuff. And that's not me. Like you guys could probably attest that that's not me. And, and that's not Lilia either. So when we take off our uniform and hang it up, like we're not cops anymore. You know, I'm just a normal person.
That's good, dog.
I try to lay low. Like you'll see me at the store and freaking socks and Crocs
and a happy dad
and happy dad hat and a freaking oversized tee, just trying to buy some ice cream.
do you have concealed?
I do carry, yeah. I carry everywhere, but that's not for like,
you have to nowadays, bro. If you have the ability to, you, it's the best thing to do.
It's for,
because not only for you but for everyone else.
I also think just the ability of like, if something does pop off, you have that power to do something.
Yeah. But there's a give and take with that, right? Like, the hard part is that, like, you know, if I'm always carrying, right, and I get into a fight, well, there's always a gun in play.
Yeah. Right?
So typically I try, if I don't have to or if I don't feel like I need to, I'll leave it in a lockbox in my car or something like that, or because you're allowed to keep it in a safe as long as it's locked. I have a safe in my truck.
I've seen some sick ones.
They have cool ones, like hidden safes and stuff like that. Mine's just a generic, like, just a lock safe.
Yeah.
And, but the flip side of that is, like, let's say I'm at the mall with my pea shooter, like my personal, it's a subcompact. I carry a subcompact Glock 45.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. I'm sorry, not a Glock 45. Glock 43X.
Okay, I'm about to say,
yes. Nice. My Glock 45 is going to be my duty weapon.
Yeah,
I'm about to say. Take this course. But I carry a 43X, which is a 10+1. You can get like extended mags for them, but I don't, because I carry it for comfort, not because
not to go to war.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that's the thing is, like, well, you know, if something pops off and I'm at the mall and like an active shooter, God forbid, you know, anything like that pops off, am I really going to go engage some dude in like Kevlar with an AR with no plate carrier, no AR, no, you know, just 10 rounds in a dream? You know,
you could probably just dump some cover fire. Yeah. Like, Kennedy would be pissed off at you now.
I'm sure he would. But not everybody's a SEAL sniper, dude. Like, <you know? laughs> I'm just a dude, bro. Like I shoot to keep my skills to par.
Yeah.
But I don't do like, I'm not in like rigorous training, of course, as you could probably tell. I don't freaking like do the Murph every day and like, you know? And there's things that people think are like unrealistic expectations of cops, right? They think we could, you know, flip and like dodge bullets and curve bullets and like all this stuff. And it's like, it's not true.
Mm.
You know, most of the time your basic patrol officer or deputy is going to be basically trained through the Academy on Firearms, and they don't have enough firearms training for the job that they should be doing.
Do you think, like, that should be different?
I do.
Do you think that the standards should be higher?
I do.
Like with like hand to hand and stuff like that?
Yeah. Yes and no. Right. I mean, you don't want, like, the hard part is that society doesn't want like trained killers, right? Like they don't want killers as cops.
Yeah.
Right. But we need to know how to defend ourselves and defend other people given those situations. So, I mean, it helps me having a background in jits and in wrestling, and I did a little bit of Muay Thai. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah, he was.
Pinnacle, right?
Yeah, Pinnacle.
He's spitting facts, bro.
Dude, I got the shit kicked out of me by like a 45-year-old man when I was like 19 years old.
Yeah.
Who barely spoke any English. The only words he could say were up, because he was telling me to keep my hands over my face while he was laying into
me. That was like your first taste.
And Matt was sitting there just laughing
in
the corner. He's like, dude, I can't believe it. I was like, dude, that fool just beat the shit.
Remember, Ruben had to tell us to calm down? Because we were just starting to throw blows.
But yeah, like going
you got emotional.
I got emotional.
Matt, I don't anymore.
Get,
when you get punched in the face, dude, like, you know, everybody's got a plan. They say like everybody's got a plan until you get punched in the face. But I think like a huge thing though is that like self defense and firearms definitely should be focused on more. Most agencies do trimester training, which is like once every 4 months. Well, trimester, so three times a year. Yeah, so you'll do it three times a year, firearms or whatever, or like quad, so it'll be like four times a year or something, like every 3 months, four times a year, you'll go shoot, and they'll put you through a different shooting scenario and stuff like that. But honestly, like, when somebody's life is depending on it, and it may not even be mine or my partner's, it may be, you know, a member of the public, like, who's to say, like, you're not going to have time to mobilize a full SWAT team. Like I said, God forbid, in the event of like an active shooter, you're not going to have time to do that.
Yeah.
Right. Because every second that you're sitting out front, this is why Columbine was such a huge thing, because they were waiting for the SWAT team while kids are actively inside getting murdered. Right. And you have a whole bunch of cops sitting on the front of their, like the hood of their car with a chew in and like not talking shit to those cops or anything, but that was how things were done at the time.
No, the same thing, I don't know if it was a year or 2 years ago, but it was at school in Texas.
Yeah, where the guy was in the barbershop and had to fucking take the barbershop's shotgun, and he went into the school.
I think he was an off-duty cop.
He was off-duty, yeah. His wife called him, hey, the school's under a mass shooting right now,
and you need kids, to go,
and they're not putting anyone in.
Yeah, the cops weren't going in.
Yeah, nobody, everyone was told to stand down. Yeah.
I try not to focus on the news too much because it's a lot of negative stuff. So I don't know like the ins and outs of like what happened at Uvalde, but it does look like it was a huge failure on the part of the command staff.
Well, I just remember watching the video, not even on the news. It was like on the internet where he was recording the cop, and the cop was just standing there like not doing anything. He's like, you're not going to go in. Like, you're not going to go in. Like, the cop didn't say anything. He was just standing right there.
And that doesn't do us any service at all, right? Like, that doesn't do anything positive for us in the eyes of the public, right?
Yeah.
Because that's what... that's what we're there to do, right? It's like law enforcement is paid to protect people and to stop threats, right? Like, that's the purpose. But
and that's the shitty thing too. I feel like if you're a good cop and like that's your order is, hey, stay here, and if you go in there, like, you're gonna get in trouble, like, get your career, right?
That's what they were saying is like, a lot of like criticism was going along the lines of how can even if you're told by like your commanding officer to stand down, don't go in, and there's everyone there, like how many, I forget how many cops, but it was crazy the amount of cops that were just on standby.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like you couldn't have coordinated one thing with a group of men that were ready to go in and risk their lives like they're sworn in to do, to protect the lives of others. And it's like, as a man, how are you capable of not doing that?
And that's the hard part.
The criticism was, it's like, and I it's think like it's at warranted. The end of the day, like, fuck, it's like fuck your orders, these kids are dying.
Yeah, and I think the criticism's act like completely warranted in that situation, because it's like, you know, how would you live with yourself if kids are getting shot and you could do something but you didn't, right?
Yeah.
And like, even if like I don't want to sit here and Monday morning quarterback like
for sure,
stuff that they do or like their protocols or procedures, because that's a different state, different way of doing things, right? However, I don't know anybody on my department or any surrounding agencies that would tell, while people are actively getting shot inside, especially kids, I don't know any agency that would tell their officers to stand down.
Yeah.
I don't know any officer that would listen to an order like that, regardless, either.
Yeah.
And, like, it's not even about, like, a lot of people, like, chalk it up to, like, oh, the officers were scared and all that stuff. But, yeah, I mean... I'm fucking scared every day. Yeah. Every day I do something
that's
where I'm
a natural
like,
emotion.
Yeah. Every day I do something where I'm like, Jesus, this is not fucking good. Right. But it's my job. It's what I have to do.
Yeah.
So sometimes you have to cowboy up and do it.
That's
right?
Called courage.
Exactly. And it's like, you carry rifles and a shotgun and a gun on your hip and a plate carrier in your car. What do you think they're for? Right. Like, what do you think that we carry that stuff for? It's because of situations like that. It's not the if, it's the when, mm-hmm. right? When you're going to need to use it. Hopefully, I never need to. I pray to God I never need to. But statistically speaking, it's getting more and more common, mm-hmm. like amongst cops nowadays, to get into shootings. My dad made it 30 years without ever having to shoot anybody.
Really?
Yeah. And
he was in some pretty...
he was in some crazy stuff. Yeah, he was on SWAT. And,
well, he was in Ontario, San Diego.
Mm-hmm.
And
he was on SWAT, and he was in, like, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of the 1995 tank pursuit.
No.
Some crazy in 1995.
Sounds crazy.
Dude, he stole a tank from, like, I think it was, like, Myanmar, from, like, a military base.
This fool knew how to steal a tank.
Apparently, stole a tank. That's... and was just cruising down the freeway, like, in a tank, running over cars and
damn,
stuff.
Like GTA?
Yeah,
damn.
Like GTA.
My God.
Wild. And my dad was in that. His FTO is actually the officer that shot the guy inside the tank because he wouldn't stop. He was trying to figure out how to get the tank moving again. So he didn't feel like there was another option to do. And like 1995, things were done completely differently.
Yeah.
So than they are now.
He got awarded and fucking praised for that.
I'm sure he got a medal. I mean, but rightfully so, right? Like if you don't have any other option to protect public safety other than to use your firearm, sometimes you have to use it. And that's the thing. Like, it's not pretty. It's never pretty having to take somebody's life. But just because it's not pretty doesn't mean it's not justified.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the hard part that I feel like the public nowadays has a hard time wrapping their minds around.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, it's like, what do you think we have it for?
Well, I think that's a hard part, too. Is like, so many people go into it, and it's presented emotionally to them. And I think it's really hard to think about it, like, from the logical side of it, of, like, mm-hmm. no, like, if you went to the training and you understood, like, the breakdown of things,
yeah,
there's a certain point where you have to do what's best for the situation.
Yeah, you can't leave with emotion in situations like that. That's why I was just talking about this other day, actually, where it's, like, there's specific scenarios where men are better to lead a situation because we lead with logic. You know, we don't lead with emotion.
Well, nowadays it's it's hard.
But, that's what it's supposed to be like. You know, I was referring to this one show I just watched was called Snowfall.
Mm-hmm.
It's like about the CIA crack epidemic in the '60s or whatever.
Yeah, I've heard of it. Yeah,
and there was this part in it that I was like, this is so savage because. It was the wife of a cartel, like it was they're like cooking up their dope in the forest, like the cartels do and shit. And there was a kid that they had came across, and the kid came in and they allowed him to be in the camp and like, you know, be a part of the camp. But he actually was an infiltration from another cartel, and he was trying to get them caught up and killed. And so the wife, and this is what's crazy about it, because it was the wife, she was like, we gotta get rid of him. And it's like, when a woman is that cold, you're like, damn,
mm-hmm.
she ain't leading with no emotions.
She got some balls.
That's a fucking savage woman right there, because she was the one who killed the fucker.
Yeah,
she was like, because the CIA agent was like, oh, we could double infiltrate, like we could send him back and get information or whatever. And she was like, nope, gotta get rid of him. And it's just that scenario right there, because it's my life or theirs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, whether it be a kid or an adult, they used him and so be it.
Yeah.
And that's where it's like, that's logic.
Yeah.
You know? And so like, that's where women rulers, like queens and shit, were more savage at, like, they would bring on a war faster than men did. They would be like, kill everyone. They're emotionally driven, right? So it's like, in those situations, now our society is emotionally driven. We can't logically think like, oh, it's this dude's life or everyone surrounding. It's like
kill one, save a
thousand. It's nature is metal, bro. It's nature.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, it's like people think that bears are plushy, but they fucking they're savages.
Yeah, that's the opposite end of it though too. Is like going back to what we were talking about, like as a cop, like either you make a decision, and like you said, it's like that phrase, "kill one, save a thousand." Like you got to think about your job this way. If I think emotionally and don't take this guy out, everything he does next, I could prevent or stop, and now that's on me.
Yeah, and that's the thing people don't understand is like we're liable regardless, right? Like either way.
Whether it's seen on the news or it's not seen on the news.
Yeah, and even if we act or we fail to act, we're liable one way or the other, right? Like, it's a fine line. It's a tightrope that, like, law enforcement has to walk. Because if you fail to act, there was that officer in Florida. I can't remember exactly which school shooting it was, but he was an SRO, and he didn't do anything. He didn't act at all. He didn't go try to stop the threat, and he had, like, every tool imaginable to him. And
what was the threat?
It was a school shooter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know the exact circumstances, but I do know he was charged criminally for failure to act. And
that's
like,
good.
Yeah. But like, there's that thing. It's like
but you don't hear about that. You won't hear about that in the news.
It's the hard part, right? Yeah. It's like, you know, if you fail to act, you're held liable. If you act and people don't like it, then it's the court of public opinion.
Yeah.
Right. Like, if people don't like the way you do something. And I always tell people, I advocate, like, go on a ride-along. Like, go see what cops do. Like, you'll have a different perspective leaving, and you'll be like, oh, wow, their job really isn't as cut and dry as I thought it was.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it's a lot of it is, like, we're given a lot of discretion. And, like, a lot of people think that just because we find, like, a dope pipe or something like that on somebody, that they automatically have to go to jail. It's discretion, right? Like, we can do what's called we can send the report to the district attorney's office without making an arrest if we see fit. There are certain things where we are mandated to arrest, but if somebody has a dope pipe, I can give them a ticket, and that's technically an infield arrest, right? I can give them a ticket. I don't have to book them into jail.
Yeah.
Now the discretion comes in, like, you know, we got like 5 or 6 calls for this dude smoking crack out in front of a Starbucks, right? Well, now it's starting to become an issue, right? And so we get 5 or 6 calls throughout the night. Well, now it's a problem solver. We'll get him out. We'll go book him into jail. He'll be out of the town for 6 hours or out of the city for 6 hours. And going back to what you said about like women, I have a lot of badass female partners.
Yeah.
There are like, and that's the thing is like, it's
that was just a broad stroke.
No, I know.
Absolutely.
But like, it's both ways. It's crazy. Cause like you'll have male partners that you could just tell are like obviously scared, right? Yeah. Like I'm scared every day, but I can't show that.
Yeah.
Right. Like I can't go.
It's normal to be scared. Like if you're not scared for your life, then
that makes you want to survive.
Right? It makes being you naive.
Fear makes you want to survive.
Exactly. I will say like it kind of gives you that regard of like living.
Exactly.
I feel like if you're not scared to die, then you're not going to care about anyone else's what comes along the way.
And it's been amplified now too because I have a baby. You know, I'm like, dude, I have to be here for him because, you know, props to all the stepdads and stuff out there. But I don't ever want anybody raising my fucking son.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I want to raise my son. And I'm going to make sure I do everything in my power to be there to raise my son and to being the man that I want him to be and that he deserves to be. And I want him to fulfill everything that he wants out of life. So I want to be there. So that gives me that will to survive.
Mm-hmm.
Like in high stress incidents, major incidents, things like that. But, you know, going back to like females, I've seen dudes who are terrified and I've seen females who are down to get down when it's time. Like,
you know, a chip on their shoulder.
It's not even like it's both ways, right? Like you'll have the cockiest guy, right, who is just terrified to do something. And then you'll have like the cockiest dude who's like 10 years in the Marine Corps and he's completely about it.
Yeah.
You know, he's everything that he says he is down, you know, 100%. And then you'll have females who are completely down. Like it's a give and take. Like you don't know.
It's like
right?
you
just
want anyone that's down and capable.
It's different from person to person. But when shit hits the fan and you're fighting and you're on the radio screaming "Mama, Mama," you want somebody that you could trust to come help you stop somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And
is that what you guys say, "Mama, Mama"?
No.
Okay. I didn't know if that was code or something.
No.
Like.
So like our code typically, like, I mean you. When you're fighting somebody, dude, honestly, anything sufficient
whatever,
over the radio, you just say, I'm fighting with one, you know, But typically if we're in a fight and, you know, and we have some leverage on the person and we can, because last thing you want to do is freak out over the radio.
Yeah. Right?
Because you freak out over the radio, you're getting a code black response. Yeah. Like, and that's not like verbiage for anything, but like, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of code green, code yellow, code black. But like code black is like everybody's out of their freaking mind.
Like end of watch, like they're all coming
flying.
End.
Yeah, yeah. Right? Total, like, not disregard, but like you're doing what you got to do to get there.
Yeah.
And if that means driving at speeds faster than pertinent, then, you know. Yeah. Yeah. You're doing that, right? Yeah. Especially like, it'd be like,
I'd be lying to watch at the end when like they're like in the alleyway, and all that, you just hear all the cops coming.
Yeah, it's some things are just reactionary, and some things you can't help. When somebody screams at you're like, your first thought is, I need to get to wherever the fuck they are.
Yeah,
right. And you don't think about anything else, right? Your lights and your sirens are on, and you're fucking going. Like, there's no...
That's your brother or sister, and you need help.
There's no stop, yeah. Right? Yeah, exactly. That's my partner. They need help. I would want them to do the same thing for me.
Yeah.
So I'm going to haul ass over there, and I'm going to help them. So, like, but if you have pertinent... Like, if you have a little bit of time to put out pertinent information, it's better to just say I'm 415 with one. Like, that's our code.
Okay.
Like, I'm fighting with one.
Yeah.
But that's, like... It'll all be in your tone and inflection.
If you're You'll be able to tell, like, yeah. All right, he needs some help.
Yeah. Or, like, somebody will say, like, oh, I'm code 4. Like, I'm... That is... Dude, you're getting code black response. Screaming that. Oh, dude. 415? At the top of your lungs?
It's just some crack bitch with the fucking... With, like, a bat or something.
A lot of it's funny. Most of, like, what we do is, like... funny stuff. Like, you can't make it up. You just see funny stuff
everywhere. Yeah.
Like some GTA
and, like,
shit.
You talk to, like, your local, like, user or something like that, and they always have a different story every time. Like, these aren't my pants, man. You know? Like, all
I think that's, like, the kind of the cool part. Like, and this is where I'll say, like, you have good cops, bad cops. Like, wherever you're... Until the end of time, like, there's gonna be good people, bad people.
Yeah.
Good teachers, bad teachers. Good politicians, bad... Like, it's same thing with cops. But, like, I always find it cool when, like... As a cop, like, you have a relationship with the community,
mm-hmm.
whether it's, like, the people or, like, even, like, the consistent people that are always getting in trouble.
Yeah.
Like, you still have a relationship and respect with them to where, like, dog, you know you're not supposed to be doing that.
Yeah. And sometimes, like, you build enough of a rapport with them, you talk to them a little bit, you know, even if you end up arresting them, you talk to them a while, they'll talk to you the next time they see you.
Yeah.
They
yeah.
won't think you're an asshole.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
You're not power tripping on them and fucking...
And that's not me, because I'm not the type of guy who looks like I'd have a power trip.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not, dude, I'm 5'11", like, 230 right now, with all this baby weight on me. But, like, I'm not the type of guy who's like, oh, you're going to go in handcuffs, or I'm going to fucking make you go in handcuffs.
You try to be more fair about shit.
I try, yeah, especially because, like, dude, there's a lot of big fucking guys out there. Dude.
Yeah.
And no matter, like, what wrestling or what jiu-jitsu you know, you can only punch somebody in the face as hard as you can. But if somebody catches you, even if they don't know how to fight, it only takes one punch.
They're
dude.
Adrenaline going to, bro, and that it's mm-hmm. just the amount of mass coming towards you.
And
bro,
I could hold on to somebody's different. Yeah, and I could hold on to somebody's back for 5 minutes, right? But how am I going to get them in a handcuffs?
Yeah,
right. And like, what purpose does it serve being an asshole to people? Like, we already have a bad reputation with the public. The public, you know. By and large, I feel like most people like us, but the media portrays us as these horrible people. And, you know, I wish more cops would speak out on that. I wish we would. But, you know, it is what it is. It's like the nature of the beast. Like, I would never go on anybody else's podcast. You guys are my best friends. So that's the only reason why I would come out here and talk about my job.
I'm happy, too, because, like, obviously, like, we talk and stuff like that. And it's cool. But, like... Even, like, obviously, like you said, like, how we have a good relationship. Like, the questions that come from this stuff, like, it's more than I thought it could be. Like,
yeah.
Because you learn.
Yeah, exactly. You and, learn. Like, I have – and that's why I'm, like, such a big advocate for, like, if people have questions, go on a ride-along. A cop will answer any question you want.
Yeah.
You want to know, right? Like, pending that it's, like, going through litigation or something like that. Like, or, you know, I mean, we're there for the public to ask questions. Like, a lot of people think that, like, a huge thing that, like, irks me – that I try to explain to people, like, most of the time it's arrestees, is, like, Miranda. Like, people think that, like, we have to read them their rights before we put them in handcuffs. It's not true. That's, like, a big misconception. Like, we read Miranda when they're in custody, and we ask them questions about the crime.
Mm-hmm.
So if, like, I have somebody in handcuffs, I'm like, hey, dude, what's your name? Like, you need to read me my rights. No, I don't. I'm asking your name. Like, yeah. It has nothing to do with what crime you may or may not have committed. Yeah. Right? But now I put somebody in handcuffs and I'm like, hey, dude, so you had that dope pipe on you. That's an issue.
Yeah.
That becomes a Miranda violation. Yeah. So that's when you have to start reading people their rights.
Well, everyone wants to be a lawyer.
Everybody does. And sometimes it's warranted, right? Yeah. Sometimes you get that auditor that baits in that cop and makes the cop just look like an idiot.
Yeah.
And it hurts me because I'm like, dude, you're just making all of us look bad, man.
Yeah. Well, dude, before we were talking about earlier, this is like probably like a month ago. I was watching it's like, it used to be Live PD. I think it's like On Patrol now.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And don't get me wrong, I don't think he's a bad cop, but like, you could just see, like, he got flustered and just overreacted on this girl. Mm-hmm. Like, she, like, was, like, trying to get something, and he swore he saw a pipe. So he, like, went, like, straight, pulled her out of the car, like, threw her out, was like, where's the pipe? Like, I saw you throw it. So, like, he's just being, like, a dick to her. Mm-hmm. Just, like, straight being a dick to her. And, like, she's like, dude, I don't have any pipe. He's like, no, I saw you throw it. I saw you throw it. So, like, as it goes on, like, they're trying to find the pipe, and they can't find the fucking pipe.
Yeah.
They're like, there's no fucking pipe. So it's just, like, dog, like, shit like that just makes you look like a dickhead because you're just, like, I don't know if you were going through something or, like, you just needed to do something, but, like.
And that's, like, a huge thing is, like, pride will get the best of
yeah.
you. Right? Like, you don't want to let your pride go. Right? But the problem is like getting an ego check as a cop and like it being on recording because everybody's recording. Yeah. Most agencies have body cams. Even if you don't make like national headlines, you still feel like an idiot.
Yeah.
Right. And like getting ego checked is probably the most humbling experience that can happen. and there's a time and a place to lose your shit on somebody. Right. Like there's a time and a place for an ass chewing. Like, but it's not. I feel like there's no point in doing it on duty. Like, there's only one time I ever really lost my cool, and it was because somebody almost freaking swerved into me. I was rolling code, which is lights and sirens, and somebody wasn't paying attention because they dropped something on their floorboard, and they swerved into my lane and literally almost went head-on with me.
Damn.
At, like, I'm going probably, like, 80 miles an hour, and they're probably going, like, 60.
Damn.
So we for sure both would have been dead.
Yeah.
So I stopped everything I was doing to go flip around and pull him over and give him a piece of my mind. And he was very apologetic, but I composed myself and he ended up leaving without a ticket. Like, I felt like I got my point across. Yeah. He was very apologetic. He understood. I got my point across. So do I need to patronize this guy any further by giving him a citation? I hate writing citations because I hate going to traffic court. But because it's like, you drive all the way to court for a 5-minute testimony and then leave. So I prefer not to. I prefer corrective violation. Like if you pull somebody over, you advise them of what they did wrong. And then hopefully in the future, they won't do that. Be like, hey, dude, you know, yeah, exactly. I'm giving you a warning, dude. You know, not a big deal. Just try to make sure you stop at stop signs, whatever reason you pull cars over for. But another thing that like people think is like, you know, when you ask them to step out of a car, like for what? Well, people don't know case law. Like you said, everybody wants to be a lawyer. People don't know case law. So there's a case law, Pennsylvania versus Mims, that says an officer can order people out of the car for no reason other than stop itself. So if I pull you over for bald tires, that's kind of a weak one. Say I pull you over for blowing a stop sign and I feel like I need to pull you out of that car. You're going to step out of that car. Then that's all there is to it. And it's like people think that, you know, oh, you have to have some extenuating reason or like something crazy to pull me out of my car. I don't. There's case law that supports that. I can pull you over just for running that stop sign. If I feel that you need to step out of the car to make my job safer, I will pull you out of the car.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of things people don't understand. And I don't fault them for it. I try to explain it to them before I do it, you know, because that's usually how you get the best amount of compliance.
Yeah.
Is when people understand why you're doing something. So I try to, if it's feasible, I try to explain to people, you know, sometimes there's not time for a lot of talk. Sometimes it's action time and things are rapidly evolving and changing. And you're like, oh, this needs to happen now. Yeah. I don't have time to sit here and talk about this. So
you like, get that feel like you're just like, yeah, this isn't going to.
The spidey sense, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, oh, this isn't going well.
Yeah.
I probably need to put this person in handcuffs before they start trying to fight me. And, like, people don't understand that, like, sometimes, like, escalating things can de-escalate things, right? So if, like, somebody doesn't want to give me, I don't know, it's just basic things, right? Like sometimes you have to point your weapon or a weapon on your tool belt. Sometimes you have to point it at somebody. They take a fighting stance on you and I pull out my taser and I'm like, hey dude, if you try to fight me, I'm gonna fucking tase you.
Yeah.
And most of the time, I can't say all the time, but most of the time, people comply with that. They're like, oh, dude, I don't want to get tased.
Yeah.
And that in and of itself de-escalates the situation, right? Like, I escalated it by pulling one of my weapons off my belt, but I de-escalated the situation because now we're not in a fist fight on the side of the road.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
you didn't call a social worker to calm it down.
That's a whole different thing. That's, yeah. I wish we had a social worker every shift. That's just not the reality. So you guys are out there and you guys want social workers out with every police officer on every shift. You guys need to contact your legislation and pass a bill.
That's interesting. The social worker.
What is that about?
I thought that's like a Pandora's box.
Oh yeah, dude. Like that. That's a rabbit hole. I mean, would it be good to have a social worker present at all times? Maybe. Right? Would it be good? Like, a lot of people think that cops shouldn't be responding to some mental health calls and that it should just be social workers. But what happens with the social worker
ass beat?
if there's a weapon involved,
like
right?
A Shiloh.
Like
Shiloh? No, because he works in behavioral health.
Oh, yeah.
So Shiloh will be getting in to people.
No more Christmas.
Yeah, no more Christmas.
And it's like... No more Christmas.
It's
a Randy story.
Yeah, my dad was telling us, because my dad goes to houses to teach autistic children, and he's like a tutor. And he pulled up on this house with another therapist, and the mother had, I don't think she let him know, but she had taken away his Christmas. The kid's Christmas,
because
he got in trouble.
Oh.
She canceled Christmas.
Santa ain't coming
this
year?
Fool was pissed the fuck off, bro. Like, and he was, like, down. My dad was downstairs with her, and then, like, the other therapist is upstairs. And all of a sudden, like, he just starts hearing this fool screaming, like, ah! And, like, the kid has the other guy, like, in the air, like, at the top of the stairs. And my dad had to run up there and, like, because my dad worked at Patton, so he knows how to detain and, like, work with those kinds of people. And he had to go do all that, and the kid like, I don't want to hurt you, and then he like scratched the fuck out of him, like,
and it's funny to laugh at, but like at the time, like that's probably a terrifying scenario for that social worker. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, so it's like those are the situations where you need like someone that's capable of
detaining someone.
Detaining a threat and being able to separate and control.
Yeah.
Like it's just, you know.
And I will say that we made leaps and bounds in mental health as far as doing that. That's actually super funny.
Yeah. I'll tell you more later.
Yeah. But like we have made leaps and bounds in that, in the fact that like most departments have a DBH, which is a Department of Behavioral Health, and they have social workers or caseworkers that'll come out if you request them. Like a lot of places have crisis teams that are willing to come out and talk. And then it's specific to the situation, right? Like what I said about us having discretion, like a lot of it is our discretion, right? Like if you feel like they don't necessarily need to be placed on a 5150 hold, which is a psychiatric hold, a 72 hour hold, but you do think that they need some help, then you can call out the crisis team, or you can call out DBH, or you can take their name and address and put it on the DBH, put it on their desk, and they'll go reach out to them. And I usually attach like the call log to it, and then just leave it on their desk, and they'll go reach out to it. Like, yeah. But the problem is everybody has, like, it seems as though everybody's having mental health crisis these days. And like DBH, like as much as I can cry and moan and complain about how law enforcement is like impacted and overworked, those guys are absolutely overwhelmed. Like, absolutely.
I think you don't have to get like a long answer on this, but like we were talking about like even like the skill plan from like a marksmanship point, like in law enforcement, like, and I always go back to incentivize like your officers to like be better skilled, be better equipped. But isn't there a way to where like you can like add like, hey, like if you're like a behavioral health specialist, like we'll give you like a bonus or a pay grade different, or like saying like a marksman. Like, do they have something like that in the department, or is it really basic still?
Well, so a lot of t- A while back, law enforcement was kind of gearing towards like everybody having a degree. They yeah. want everybody to have a degree, show them that you're educated. But the problem with that is...
I don't even think that happens. I think it's just be very specialized. Like, there's yeah. certain things that people are good at that they should be, like, in on. And then there's other things that other people are good at that they should be in on. I don't think, like, a degree
differentiates that. A lot of it comes down to lived experience, yeah. I feel like. And, like, the longer you're on as a cop and the older that you get in life... the more life experience you get, the more, you know, like, obviously somebody who has a family member with a mental disability or somebody whose brother, sister, mom, dad is schizophrenic is obviously going to have way more knowledge than your 21-year-old who just graduated college, was from an upper middle class family, and just became a cop because they thought it was cool. Right? Yeah. Like, they're going to have a lot more experience. Just like you're going to have, you know, somebody who grew up with parents who were doing dope and wanted to get out of that lifestyle and became a police officer because cops were in and out of their house so much. This is a true story from yeah. one of my partners that I heard. Her backstory is that her parents were both addicts, and dad ended up leaving, and she noticed that, like, you know, every time cops were in and out of the house, that was the only time she felt safe. So she wanted, when she grew up, to be a cop to give some other kids that safety, right? You think anybody's going to know more about dope than her? Probably not. You can take classes all you want, but you see that firsthand.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
And you'll get that on the job anyways, but she came into the job knowing how it is. She yeah. knows how addicts work. She knows what they do, what they're willing to do,
yeah,
right?
For sure.
So it's just, it's the differences in lived experience. So that is a really hard question to answer. Because, yeah, you can get as much training yeah. as you want on it.
And I get what you're saying there. My more thing is, like, let's say you're an officer and you just got out of the jails and, you know what, like, I like what I do, but, you know, like you said, I have a family members that are, like, that have mental illness. I really want to help people on that side of things. Hey, like, let me go to school and specialize in this thing so that I can be, like, a behavioral health officer. And then, whether it's, like, a pay increase or, like a bonus increase.
There should be yeah. incentives, yeah.
Like something like that to where, like, instead of just being a basic police officer, like, hey, you get out of the academy and you just do your time and keep doing it, like...
Or go straight to the streets if you're with yeah. a city agency, like, city police department.
Yeah, I yeah. feel like if you incentivize it, you're going to get better quality officers because, one, they're getting compensated, and, two, they're specializing in things that really matter to them.
Well, yeah, and a hard part now yeah. is, like... Finding people that want to be cops, yeah, right? Nobody wants to be a freaking cop now. And, like, I'm on my department's recruitment team, and I've helped with background interviews and stuff like that. And let me tell you, like, by diminishing the law enforcement profession, you don't get the candidates that you guys want to see.
Yeah.
We also don't even have people that are qualified, too. Because Tim Kennedy was just talking about this with the military. It's the worst it's ever been.
Yeah.
Like, it's scary. It's scary how bad it is. Yeah, how, yes. like, there's no people... The people are not qualified. Yeah. And they're talking about even reducing how strenuous it is for, like, SEALs and shit. Mm-hmm. Like, BUDs and shit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, they're considering, like, making it less hard or something like that.
And as it relates to law enforcement, I can give you guys two huge things, red flags, that should terrify everybody. One... LAPD just put through their first class of non-citizen police officers.
Dude, yeah. That's something that's coming up too.
That should scare the fuck out of everybody. And it has nothing to do with where they're coming from, anything like that. You are a U.S. citizen, right? Let's say a non-citizen police officer who doesn't understand the rights because they've never lived in America, they don't understand, they're not a citizen. They don't have a concept of the rights that we hold so dear to us, right, yeah. as citizens. And they're going to be tasked with potentially taking your rights from you.
Yeah.
Because that's what it is. When yeah. we arrest yeah. people, we seize their rights, right? It's a seizure.
Yeah.
Right? So the Fourth Amendment, you know, unreasonable search and seizure, how like, that should scare you.
Yeah.
And number two, and I think it's Detroit Police Department, they're hiring convicted felons. Mm-hmm. As police officers.
When you see, the scary thing for me on that one, the thing that comes into my head is, like, you're giving them power. You're giving them the ability to, like...
Have access to a lot of things. And like I said, when you give people the ability to exploit something, they will.
Yes. And they've already displayed yeah. a pattern of criminal activity as a citizen. Yeah. Why would we yeah. give them a badge and a gun and tell them to go protect the public.
Well, I'm just thinking, like, that can potentially you guys can just look up, like, you're not supposed to, but, like, you can just look up anybody and get all their information.
Yes.
So you're going
to
get
yes, we are trusted with a lot of access like
their,
systems.
Their whole background.
Yeah, yeah. Where, they live.
You're not supposed to do it, but, like, if I'm a, so let's say I'm from another country, or I'm an ex-felon, I'm like, hey, I want to know where this guy lives and all that stuff. Like, you're giving this information
to people. Yeah, and if they're a felon.
Be plants, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, and about the corruption, like I said, there's if there's something to exploit, intelligent people are going to exploit it.
Cartel plants.
Mm-hmm. And if they're a felon.
There's already cartel plants in police.
Not even other countries, dog.
Well, yeah.
Other countries.
Oh, like China.
Anything.
Because there's a lot of Chinese men.
International terrorists. You think, okay, let's think about San Bernardino. Let's say that homeboy, when he did the thing in 2015.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's say that you guys have plants in the sheriff's that will give him all the calls. So now they have they know all your guys' protocols. They know exactly how you're going to do everything.
Yeah.
Because they have those guys in there.
And they can counterplan.
So it's going to be, exactly, it's going to make it harder because he's going to know what you guys are going to do.
Yeah.
And it's a scary thought. Yeah. It's a scary thought. But, you know, I'm not, like I said, I don't really watch the news too much. So I don't know a lot of, I mean, obviously everybody's heard the border's like a mess right now, but I don't really know like the specifics on what's going on with that. But yeah, it's scary to think about, like, because like these agencies, some people are lowering their hiring standards and some people are not the best quality of applicant coming in. And we're giving them a badge and a gun. And like with Detroit, where they're hiring felons, these people have already displayed a pattern that they can't be trusted in society, right? That's why they were in prison.
They can't even vote if they're a felon.
Well, I'm sure that's probably going to change at some point, too.
That's crazy, bro.
But it's like, it's a scary...
We're going backwards to society.
It's a scary thought because you're giving these people access to all these confidential databases, systems, and stuff that are basically ran on trust, right? Mm-hmm. They're like, they're audited, but how much are they audited? Like, I don't know. That's behind-the-scenes stuff that I've never seen.
Look at other third-world countries and their police departments. All of them are owned by whoever's in power.
Yeah.
So like, this is a horrible example to use because it's from a movie, but like, I think it was like in Fast Five when like they're in Brazil and like the guy, he basically owns the whole city. So like all the police are like working for him and doing all that stuff. It's like when you can exploit and have corruption and get people access to these things, like you already know.
And I heard something too about how like all these illegal immigrants coming across the border now, like what they're gonna consider too is if you wanna be a part of the U.S. then you're gonna have to serve our military. So now that, because now it's like a trade off, it's like, oh, you wanna come in here and be in the U.S. you're gonna serve our military. That way, because it's like you're gonna protect our country.
Even the moral compass is horrible though too.
But they're doing it with police departments and shit too. So it's like you gotta imagine they do that with the military. Now you're giving more.
Yeah.
Like it's like whoever's in control can tell them like, oh, we gotta seize this. We gotta lock things down.
I gotta take piss, dude.
Okay.
I cannot hold it anymore.
I'm gonna pause it then. All right. Now that we're back from that short little restroom break.
A little potty break. Yeah.
And we're back to the Cinecast.
Yeah, we're back. So kind of transitioning because of the time that we had, I want to talk about a little conversation that me and you had when we had a little BK bash up.
Oh, yeah.
And kind of just overall, like...
Was that the after hours BK bash?
Yeah, that was after. It was just, no, but it was a good conversation. Yeah, yeah. And I feel like from your own personal standpoint, just kind of talking about like your transition, because obviously we're all friends here. We've been friends since freaking elementary, middle school.
Elementary.
So, just like for people that know Austin Trousas, like how do you feel just like kind of maturing and everything like that? Like how have you changed and just seen things differently?
Well, I mean, I look back and there's obviously like I'm sure everybody does, they have things that they would have done differently in their life. But that's why it's life, right? It's all a learning experience. I mean, sometimes I acted like a little asshole, you know, being a younger version of myself. And I feel like maybe seeing the world now gives me perspective, and that's probably one of the biggest things that I thank God for is now I have perspective on things. There's a lot of it's hard, right? Like you think about it and you have all the words, but it's hard to put them out.
Yeah.
But for me, there's people that I truly wish I would have treated better. And people that I wish I wasn't, you know, a high school kid to, you know.
I mean, how I look at it is, like, we're all, like, at the time, we're all trying to figure stuff out. Like, I mean, you're a very different person than you were in high school.
Oh, man.
Yeah, like, I don't think necessarily it's like, oh, like, you were a bad person. I think, like, you kind of just had this idea of life, and no shit, you're an 18-year-old, 19-year-old kid.
Yeah.
Thinking, like, you have it all figured out.
Yeah.
At some point. And yeah. I think the biggest thing you probably look at is just, like, obviously with, like, you knew what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
Like, you knew what you wanted to do, so you kind of had that set in your ear, and maybe it kind of, like, gave you a little tunnel vision.
I do think it did. I feel like I kind of, like I talked earlier about those people who act like they're cops on duty and off duty, like, just hut, hypervigilant and all that stuff. Like, yeah, it's good to a certain extent, but that stuff can ruin relationships, and it can ruin your friendships with people. And that's something that I found out the hard way when I was like 18, 19 years old. I wasn't even a cop yet. And because I knew what I wanted to do, and I would go into law enforcement, I would see, you know, people doing things that contradicted with my morals at the time. And I felt like I would pass judgment on them when I didn't have any right to do that. Right.
It's completely normal, though. I think you're completely validated in that, because you're trying to. You, honestly, it's more admirable doing that, even though you seem to be counterproductive in relationships. But at some point in our lives, we have to figure out what sacrifice is, and you have to sacrifice certain things, which might be relationships, in order to proceed in that process. But if you have, like, real friends that understand that, we could be mad in the time being temporarily, and, like, we come back around and things are back to normal. It's just, it is what it is. It's the phase you're going through. You know?
It's true.
And you stuck with it, which is admirable, right? Yeah. Like, you had to,
yeah,
in order to, you had to play the part to be the part.
Yeah.
And I don't think that you're wrong for that. I think you're just figuring out how to navigate that. And that's totally understandable.
Yeah. And I think that's the cool part about it. It's like the growth.
Yeah.
It's like you're coming out of that, seeing the bigger picture.
It is a lot of personal growth that I feel that I went through, you know. Obviously, you guys have been there for me through,
yeah,
prior to being a cop, like you said, from elementary, middle school on.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you guys, if you guys notice the growth, then obviously that's a sign I'm doing something right.
Yeah, yeah. Like I told you, when I had that conversation with you 2 weeks ago, like, it just, I can see, like, from your perspective now of, like, and I think he put it nicely, it is admirable, because you knew what you wanted to do, you set out to do it. And I respect you for that, because a lot of people, like, there's, like, that gray area that they try to do both sides, and
that was it's me,
tough.
Bro.
Yeah,
that was
it's
me.
Tough.
Look, like, okay, you're more admirable in the sense of doing that for being more mature than I was in that area, but I was more mature than you in life experience, because I was out there stepping out doing the fucking most.
Exactly.
So, like, I had more maturity in life experience, but it was a downfall of my maturity towards being serious towards the job.
Yeah.
Because it fucked with my process of excelling in it, because I got hurt and things like that. I wasn't taking care of myself.
Yeah.
But I understood people more.
Yeah.
And you, and, like, my problems were different problems than your problems.
Yeah.
And that's where it's like, that's the fine line of, like, what's right and what's wrong in that process, you know? Like,
I think the main thing that I wanted to get across was that I could have been more tactful in my approach to people.
Yeah.
Especially people that I considered close friends.
Yeah.
Right. And now some of those people that are close friends, I don't know if they even want to have a conversation with me anymore. I would 100% be willing to reach out to anybody that used to be one of my friends.
Yeah.
I have no problem with that. You know, but I understand where they're coming from if they're not ready to talk to me.
Yeah.
Because I did pass judgment and I wasn't tactful with it. I would tell people, you know, you're going to die if you do that shit. You know, what 18-year-old wants to hear that when they're trying to have a good time? You know what I mean? Especially from somebody that's supposed to be their friend. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, and I mean, we've had freaking Clint on here too. And, like, I mean, you and Clint have always been close friends.
Yeah.
And I feel like right there, like you said, like 2 weeks ago, like, dude, I love Clint.
Yeah.
I love Clint. Like, there's some time where you didn't agree with everything he did, but you always love Clint. Now you kind of, like, it's like we're all mature now. And, like, you and Clint now are fucking always fucking talking and close as fuck.
I mean, Clint's my boy. And, like, nothing – and I had to get over myself to see that nothing's going to change that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, I love him because he's my buddy. You know what I mean? He's he's been one of my best friends. Yeah. Just like, you guys, I love you guys. Regardless of what you guys do with your life, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, let's say this would never happen, but let's say we had another friend in the group, right, that ended up getting addicted to something. I would do everything in my power. The old me would have said, no, fuck that guy.
Yeah.
We're not going to fucking talk to him.
Yeah.
I'm not going to talk to him
anymore. Yeah.
I would do everything in my power now to try to help him, you know? Yeah. And that's kind of the thing that I've seen, like, working this job in hindsight, is that the saddest things are when people give up on their family and their friends. That's horrible to me.
Yeah.
I think it's so sad when somebody has nobody and they die alone, or they end up with nobody to help them, and they're going down a road where they don't know where it's going to lead. Right.
Can I give a different view on that?
Yeah.
'Cause I've experienced that. Sometimes you, quote unquote, giving up on the person is doing the best thing for both of you, because there is no positive benefit in both of you being together.
No mutual benefit.
Yeah, there was no longer serving of each other in a positive way.
Yeah,
the person could very well have pushed everyone away and don't let anyone else into not open enough to receive help.
Yeah.
So those are the shitty situations where it's like, yeah, because I've had to give up on my mom in a lot of different situations, and it's very heartbreaking, but it was the best thing for both of us.
But to piggyback off of that, when she would, you know, when whatever would happen, or like in our situation, like if the old me would have been like, oh, I'm never speaking to them again.
Yeah.
Now that I have the benefit of perspective, even though I may not agree with what they do.
Yeah.
If they seek help, and I get like giving up on somebody, right? Yeah. For the separation.
I'm not trying to counter yours.
No.
I was just putting another one out there.
But if they were to come back and say, you know what? Hey, I did this. Sorry.
Yeah.
Move on.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah,
then it's back in, right? Like I guess my take on giving up would be like never speaking to them, cutting ties completely,
just totally exiling them.
Okay. And I would never. I've felt shame,
From your point of view,
yes,
I'm sorry.
From your point of view.
Okay.
And I've felt shame before, right? And I'm sure all you guys that you guys have too. And it doesn't feel good.
Yeah.
Right. So the last thing I would ever want to do is shame somebody else for their personal decisions in their life.
Yeah.
We can learn from it and move past it. But I would never sit there like I used to and pass judgment and shame people.
Got you. Okay.
And talk shit on them.
Yeah.
Right. When whatever they do affects their own life, it has nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
So a lot of it is like growing up, staying in my lane, you know,
for sure.
And just being there. Right. So if my friends that, you know, that used to be my friends that no longer want to be my friends or are not my friends now, want to have a conversation, you know, I'd be more than willing to. Mm-hmm. Out of respect, I haven't reached out to people. I've reached out we'll say names.
Yeah.
Like,
if you want
to. Is that your?
Yeah.
Whatever you want to do.
Yeah. You know, I just feel like, and this is kind of like a separate take, but, I don't know what happened, but Reed and I stopped talking through just the years, I guess, just fell out of communication. Not anything that he did wrong or I did wrong.
Yeah.
I don't think on my end. Maybe if I did something to upset him, then, you know, I apologize for that. I've done a lot of things to upset a lot of people.
No, I think Reed's laid back. I mean,
I talked to Reed. Reed, like more than anybody, is super just, what's up, dude?
Yeah. But
like,
also, I think just, when we get around this age, too,
your message.
When we get around this age, too, people are in, like, committed relationships. Right?
Yeah.
You know,
and it's harder to get around. And Reed has a baby. And, you know, and I've reached out to Reed a couple times, tell him congrats on the baby. And I hope he was a boy, right?
Yeah,
I hope he's doing well, and I hope he's growing and getting big. I hope Reed and Melissa are doing well, and I hope their relationship is well. And I've reached out to Reed a couple times, and I would like to hang out with Reed. And
yeah, you'll probably see my mania.
Okay.
Yeah, you'll probably see my mania.
Try to get off mania. Can't tell my sergeant when I'm trying to get off, but he'll be like, mania, what the fuck?
Don't worry about it.
Hey, Sarge, don't worry about it.
It's a BK bash.
Just a bunch of bad kids.
No, that was good, dude. Like, guys, I'm really happy, like I said, just hearing that. Because at the end of the day, like, it's always good to hear your close ones, your friends, like, kind of grow. Because then it kind of hit that own individual self. Like, myself, like, okay, cool. Like, if you're working on that and you went up to that, like, dude, there's things about myself that I can look at and be like, okay, why am I, like, still holding on there? Or why am I still, like, not upset, but why does that still bug me?
Yeah.
And it's just like, okay, cool. Like, you know what? Like, if you can grow up and get past that, then, like, for me, like, okay, there's some stuff I can get past to arc it over.
And yeah. Just a lot of things, like, you know, in 30 years, God willing, I'm alive and healthy enough to work for 30 years. In 30 years, I'm going to hang up this job, and I'm never going to do it again, right? But the friendships that I have now and the family that I have are going to be there forever, right? The job won't always be there. Eventually, I'm going to stop being a cop. And it took me getting past that narrow mindset to realize that, hey, I'm not going to be a cop forever.
Yeah. It's your identity.
Exactly. And that's what I didn't want, right? I didn't want being a cop to be my identity.
Yeah.
And I feel like being 18, 19, I tried to make it my identity.
For sure.
Because I idolized cops so much.
You're young, dumb, and full of cum, dog.
Well, I think that's also, like, it just goes to, like, you were just trying to step into a role, bro. Everyone's and as a young identity. Man, we're pretty gung-ho. Like, we're pretty, like, fucking hell yeah, let's get it, and I'm a stick to it. You know, if you're passionate about it, right? So it's like, That's totally understandable. Like, I lived in a lot of paranoia.
I'm sure
you wouldn't want to live in that much paranoia. You know what I mean?
No.
And that's understandable, because, like, why would you want to live like that? You're trying to live how you're supposed to live in that role.
Yeah.
So it's like, you went
and
go home.
But the main thing is like, and people talk shit on Kanye all the time, but I think Kanye probably had one of my favorite quotes of all time, and I use it a lot. Kanye said, "The only person I agree 100% with is myself." Right? I'm the only person that's going to see the world the way that I see it. Right? Yeah. There might be cops that watch this podcast and be like, "Dude, this fucking guy doesn't know what he's talking about."
And
it may be true, but it's my point of view. Right? Yeah. It's what I see in the world.
For sure.
Right? And just like, I'm sure, you know, you guys have it at your work. Right?
Now you can look at that Kanye quote completely differently. So
I
appreciate that.
I think it's a, like, one of the best quotes.
No, that is.
I think it's one of the best quotes ever.
Yeah.
No, the only person I agree 100% with is myself. And I took that and I was like, you know what? That's crazy. Because even though I may not condone some of my friends or family's lifestyle, it doesn't mean that I love them. I don't love them or that I love them any less, right? Like, you guys will always be my best friends.
Yeah.
Will you guys make decisions, or will I make decisions that you guys don't think is the best? I'm sure. Definitely. But the thing is we're all our own people, right?
Yeah.
What's fucking awesome is that we can come together and we could sit down and we could talk about the old days and then talk about the memories that we're going to make.
And then watch John Cena and Van Dan wrestle.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. We're just accepting of each other, man. Yeah. It's exactly. Because you don't want to be around people that are passing judgment and talking shit behind your back.
And that's why I hold no animosity to the people that have cut me off in the past or that I've cut off in the past.
Yeah.
Because who wants to be around that? Yeah. I don't want to be known as that negative fucking asshole. That's not what I don't want people to think of me and have that connotation to me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
dude, well, I'm proud of you for, I'm proud of you for, like, growing that and getting past that, because, like I said, that not only I think helps other people that are listening to this, but, like I said, for myself, because, like, dude, if Austin can, like, be so down to being a cop and then kind of like, oh my god, so you change, your values change, but be more understanding.
Yeah.
It's like, it goes back to, like, well, the shit that I'm fucking playing on trail, the shit that bugs me, like, why I can probably be better about being a little more understanding to it as well.
And it has nothing to do with value change at all. I still think.
Exactly.
You know, I still think some lifestyle choices are horrible, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, at the same flip of the coin, what's worse, somebody using, you know, heroin or somebody eating themselves into a fucking coma? Right? They're both bad for the body. It's just one's been deemed by the government to be illegal. Right?
That is true.
You know? And yeah, they're horrible, but, you know, I think drugs are horrible and they should be eradicated from society, but it'll never happen. It's just not the world we live in. Right? But I can sit there and pass judgment on users, or I can do what I can to try to help them. You know what I mean? Passing judgment on people does nothing.
Yeah.
Right? It serves no purpose in life other than making ourselves feel better about ourselves. So
temporarily.
And then you 5 years later, like me, lay down one night and you're like, fuck, dude, I was really an asshole to people. You know, and I don't want to be known as that guy. That's not the type of person I am now.
Yeah.
And I feel like back then I was just trying, like you said, trying to play a part. So I wish everybody the best, and I hope everybody has happiness.
I know, you know, I appreciate that. I want to get you out of here because I know you're waiting. So you want to have any closing statements? Go for it now.
I had a baby 5 months ago. His name is Miles. He's fat as fuck. He's a big boy. He's healthy. I love him. And I got to go change a shitty diaper. So that's why I got to get out of here.
All right. Well, thank you for coming on. It was a really, really good conversation.
Yeah, I love this time. This is a good one.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, no, appreciate the time.
I wish we had got to talk about gorillas more.
Yeah.
Oh, damn. All right, we can come back on.
Yeah.
You can come back on.
Whatever. Hopefully Shiloh's there.
No, Shiloh'll be there. I don't know.
Okay. Send a cast hope. With Austin Trousas.
I just hope Shiloh, hope you're well. Yeah. Hope you're doing well. But we're not going to have you kiss this one off, so.
I miss you, Shiloh.
Until next
time. Should we all kiss it?
No, I'm not doing it.
All right.